About 4 years ago, our club went from 35 members to 9. And we were at a crossroads, what were we going to do? And as of today, we're at 24. But during that year when I was president, thank you. So I want to briefly share with you what we did. It was a team effort with the whole club. We were a club that was a dinner club. We were meeting at a kids' restaurant bar with pinball machines and games and kids running and screaming all over the place. We were a full dinner club. We had a speaker every week. And our fees were probably $25 to $30 for dinner and our meeting. And it wasn't working, clearly. So we had to change. And we decided we were going to a better venue, and we did. We went to our country club at my golf club, which is a prestigious one. So we had a nice meeting event for professionals to come. We decided to change our format. We became a cocktail club where we didn't charge any fees. We had no fees for dinner. So basically, the fees were zero unless you wanted a drink. We decided to have a speaker once a month so that the club could actually have a good attendance. We decided to do a meeting of networking for young people. We said we want young people in our club, and as that you could see, our videos were all produced by young people in our club. We decided to do a club assembly once a month and a social and a service project. And if Liz, and the reason we did this, I'm, as many of you may or may not know, I'm a family doctor, and we try to practice medicine based on evidence-based medicine, which is on scientific proven data therapies. So I looked at some data, and about 4 or 5 years ago, Jennifer was leading the revitalization, rebranding of Rotary, and there was some very big data that came out of that. And Liz, if you could show that slide, it said, why did people join Rotary? And these two slides, I would like you to really look at these slides, because this is the basis on what we did for our club, and it's remained so. Why did people join Rotary? And there's these top five reasons, but you can see the top two. The first one was for service, and the second one was for friendship and fellowship. Now, Liz, if you could show the second slide, please. And then the second reason goes to retention. Why do people stay in Rotary? And you can see they're the exact same two reasons, but they're inverted very slightly. People stayed because of friendship and fellowship, and service became number two, but very close. So based on this data, that's how we decided we were going to run our club. If members are joining for service, let's give them service. So we decided we need to do service projects in our club, hands-on service projects. And we started within the last year or two under our guidance of our community chair, Elvira, and Maria Price, and Elvira DeJesu. And now we have our members out in the community, and we all wear the same Rotary Club of LaSalle Centennial shirt, and we're out doing movie nights, and we're out doing holiday hope baskets, and we're out in the community giving hands-on, cleaning up gardens. And this is what many clubs are already doing. But we needed our new members and our members to do that, which went to retention and growth. And then the other reason was friendship and fellowship. Of all those four meetings I mentioned, which one do you think is the most well-attended meeting? Yes, the ones where we all drink and party and get together. I always say Rotary gets done at the bar. So, you can attest to that last night. And that is true. So we have a fellowship meeting at least we try once a month, and that's where we talk about, and that's where the bonds and the friendships are really, really get developed. So in a basic nutshell, many of your clubs are doing that, but the message I want to give is look at that data, and when you're looking at membership engagement, recruitment, and retention, just think of those two data points, fellowship and friendship and service. And I think that has worked very well from our club, and it will do going forward.